It reaches you in some dimension or in multiple dimensions.
It's very intimidating. It's something you can't see. It's purely going off of feeling. The kite is very powerful and should be respected.
Honestly, you think about those dreams that you have of flying, that's what it's like when you're kiteboarding.
Being able to combine these elements together, I think it's a big draw for people, and it brings out the little kid in them that used to fly a kite.
I decided a while back that the ocean and water sports were going to be a passion in my life. I wasn't sure how I was going to be able to keep it in my life, but when kiting came about, it gave me this chance to be able to chase the water, harness the wind, and touch all these elements, and now it's been such a driving force in my life. I came to Puerto Rico about 2.5 years ago, and a friend of mine introduced me to a spot called La Peguera. It's on the southwest Caribbean side of the island. It was really unique and nothing like I had seen before, especially for kiteboarding. There was no beach. It was a mixture of these beautiful mangroves, small islands, and shallow, flat, warm water. It's unbelievable, and it's really a kiting paradise for beginners and pros alike because it offers such unique and perfect conditions. I invited 12 riders down to my kite house in La Peguera so they could experience these great conditions for themselves firsthand. The next day, some of the riders and myself headed out to a place called Laurel Island. Laurel Island's like my sanctuary. It's a nice little island, it's all protected. It's a small place, but it's real big in my head because it lets me go out there and just relax. And I think the other people, once they got out there, realized that, and I saw a few jaws drop when they got there. That's my special spot to take people that are, you know, that I feel are really enjoying the sport, and that's why I like to show them, you know, the true meaning of the sport and make them a part of the tribe. You know, we're about 3 miles from anywhere buddy around us and nobody will really get out to us today out here, so it's kind of like our little oasis today.
Oh, it's so beautiful! Look at the blue water.
Just straight through on the outside. We can go all the way up. We can get the boat down to there. You know, you have the whole run.
Yeah.
And stuff. We'll just go out there and see. I want to see where the wind's at on it, but it looks like it's we got more east in it today, so it should be a little bit better.
I started kiteboarding living in New Zealand. Before that, I was really into snowboarding, just chasing the snow all over the world. And my friends there were getting into kiting. They were windsurfers. And in this time, there was really no instruction. Like, I didn't have anyone to teach me. So I had to learn everything the hard way. And I think that that snowboarding influence comes across to my kiting a little bit. I really like the big jumps and a lot of the inverted, tweaked out grabs. This sort of fluid style definitely inspires me.
We'll talk to you guys.
Peek. Don't peek.
Flat water. We got a balloon up there. It's gonna be good. It's gonna be really good. It looks nice. Beautiful day.
My whole family was in skiing. My cousin was on the U.S. ski team. All day long was training, and it just got a little tiring. The dedication from skiing definitely paid off. Took it into kiteboarding and just made me totally excel, and I really like it. It's how far you want to push it, so.
I think it looks pretty good. We got a big area over here to ride. I think you gotta be careful a little bit. There looks like there could be some rocks and stuff, so we're gonna try not to fall too much, but other than that, looks like the wind's good. We should have some fun. I moved to Maui after high school, and I lived there about 5 years. And through middle school and high school, I was really into motocross. I was riding dirt bikes, and when I moved to Hawaii, I started riding again. And I got really into it, and it was just an amazing sport. But unfortunately, motocross, you get a lot of injuries in the sport. If you want to get really good at it, you have to pay your dues, and unfortunately, that is usually broken bones. After recovering from a few accidents and broken bones, I actually was getting fed up with getting hurt, and I was like, I can't keep doing this, and went to the beach and I saw someone kiteboarding in Maui, and I was just blown away, and I was like, okay, this is something I might want to try.
And be able to hold on to something and grab that bar and feel, I guess, the energy of the wind and have it pull you and go around. You're self-sufficient. You don't need any fuels. You're good for the environment. Kiting's an amazing sport.
In kiteboarding, the kite serves as a motor for us, and that bar that you see us using serves as our gas pedal. We wear what we call a harness around our waist, and this will hold all the power for the kite. Your center of gravity is located in your waist, so you can really use this besides your upper body. So with this harness around us, we're able to take the small loop that you see from the kite in the center lines, hook it into our harness, and it takes some of the weight off of our arms. That way we can power up, power down, glide through, and get a lot more duration out of it, and control how much power we have. So when we bring that kite up towards 12 o'clock and let it go and we take off into the air, we can also come gliding down. That's what makes that smooth look and approach for it.
Day I come in just happy, like that's why I go out and go kiting. You know, I want to go out there and just have a fun time, and it is going to be a fun time. You can have your bad day, but your worst day kiting is going to be better than any day you'll have in the office. I've been a nerd all the way through college, not doing any sports, kind of locked in school, and I was in medical school. Only thing I ever got a chance to do is after I was finished taking summer school every summer, I'd have around a week to go windsurf. Since I grew up windsurfing here, and I was doing a physician's program where I went with a surgeon, instructor of this medical school, down to here in Puerto Rico and Cabarete and the Dominican Republic, and there was kiting there. And basically, my friends pressured me into giving it a try. Everyone kind of knows who I am, but they don't. They don't really know who you are, and they know what your image is. They don't know who you are.
The spot's special as it is, you know? And it's hard to get out to, and I've just showed these guys and given them the keys and the map how to get out there, and it was really cool to see how they took to that. My daydream has been in this sport since I started. You know, it's been to go out somewhere, have a bunch of people just help you out, everybody kind of working together, go ride on the flat water. If I would have saw you smile, I could see you smiling like from the whole other end of the thing today and stuff. That's what it's kind of all about this week. It's a spirit, it's a state of mind in my head. And my backyard was today where we were out there kiting at.
Wakeboarding kind of set up a lot of the, you know, the no whip, the hardcore power tricks that we're doing. You can go out and double overhead waves and kite, you know, and it doesn't involve wakeboarding at all, but it involves a lot of surfing and a lot of skill. It's a blend of a lot of different sports, you know, windsurfing, wakeboarding, surfing, all of it.
Big wave surfing is really fun on kites, but I actually prefer like medium-sized waves, but when the waves get like as big as that building back over there, we even get barreled nowadays. Don't tell the surfers.
You can ride a wave for miles. Coming from a surf background, it was ideal to just get in this sport. The wave closes out, go right around the closeout section and just keep going.
Jason Slezak, I mean, him and Sam came. I just recently met Sam, so I didn't know a lot about Sam and discovered that he's a really good rider and a really decent guy as well. Just real down to earth. Slezak. I've known him. We all started out together. Jason was at the same level, and we all kind of worked each other trying to get good at the sport. Renee, I've been kiting with her for a while, and she's become like a bit of the icon in the woman's eyes and stuff like that. She's a talented rider. She goes out there, and whether Renee's doing something on the water or something on the land or whatever else, she's very aggressive. She's very aggro. She just goes out there and throws it down. Scott Harwood is an amazing, amazing wakeboarding guy. He's a guru. Scott has that talent that he's kind of shed on to me, and hopefully that people think I have, that you just look at somebody and go, hey, you know what? You just need to do this.
Hey, Andy, when you try the five, don't think ahead. You got me?
What's up today? Hey, you guys want to go riding?
Let's ride.
Got a secret spot.
Oh, sorry. I met Cameron down there because his Cameron's actually from, weird enough, La Peguera. That's where he was born at. He's the only blonde-haired Puerto Rican that'll ever be down there, I'm sure. Cameron's only been kiting a solid year, and I mean, he definitely, you can see some natural talent in him. So I started working with him a little bit, kind of coaching him, and he's really turned out to be something.
We have like this really nice sandy beach with some palm trees, and the water's really nice there, and so it's kind of protected. It's perfect. It's about the secret spot.
I grew up in a really religious family, and I can't necessarily say that I am, but at the same time, like, that's what kiting does for me. And in the last 3 months, I've been hit by a Suburban, broke my back. I can get out on the water and feel good and feel healthy, and like, I think I heal faster. I think things just work out better.
There and the wind's pretty strong, and just because it's windy doesn't mean that it's conditions to go out.
Pretty incredible, like, be able to lift yourself off of flat water. And you know, when you get in the air, you have a period of time where like you match the wind speed, so the noise of like riding on the water and the wind noise and everything goes away. And the wind went up to around 50 miles an hour, the weather station said. Well, actually, it was 50 knots. I guess that's 60-something miles an hour.
We were freaking out. We were all jumping out of the water, pulling the emergency release on the kite, trying to get him to the ground and get in without hitting the land. It was onshore winds where we were. So everybody was getting teabagged and lifted up towards the shore, towards the palm trees. It was kind of scary.
Thank you.
Well, earlier today, actually, Paul was reading the paper, and he said there was a storm coming in, but I guess we all failed to kind of remember that. It started coming up, and I think, I don't know, I was trying to come in because I could feel it, and then all of a sudden, just huge gusts started coming. It just picked up quick, all of a sudden, from a hard, steady wind into, like, gnarly, gnarly wind. It was crazy. Really.
What happened to your kite?
Mine? Yeah. Gone. In the trees.
Gone?
No, well, I retrieved it, but it's a lot of holes, a lot of thorns, a lot of tangling, a lot of fun.
It was pretty insane. It was a really heavy squall. I think the wind doubled. I don't know how hard it was blowing, but safety systems were going everywhere. It was pretty insane. Pretty insane. I think it was going somewhere between 40 and 50. I guess you have to have a real teeny kite for this.
I think a lot of people who kite use the sport to escape and in some ways clear their minds and deal with situations in their lives.
What happened was it was me, Philippe, my best friend, and two ski patrollers. And all of us got caught in an avalanche. There was absolutely nothing you can do. It's just a big, huge white cloud coming right at you, and like that. So, in a matter of seconds, just tumbling down the whole mountain, and everything just stopped, and everything was black. I couldn't move anything but my toes and my snowboard boots. And I kept on thinking, I don't want to die, I don't want to die. I couldn't barely breathe, and I think I passed out because I was under the snow for 18 minutes, which is a long time for someone to survive that, I guess, under 1 meter of snow. And my best friend, he didn't make it.
We've had a bunch of weird tragedies. I know both Sam and I, like Sam lost a number of friends this winter.
We lived down here in Puerto Rico. Our buddy Matt, I mean, we lived with him down here. And I think while I was down here, like pretty much two of my friends passed away. And then, I mean, the day I get back to Hatteras, one of my friends passed away. And then, I mean, the whole accident involving everybody that we work with.
And I lost a girl that I had dated for a number of years, like all through high school. Dated this girl for like 9 years. She died in a car accident, and honestly, that was right when I had really gotten into traveling and trying to make something out of kiting. You know, like you get out on the water and you're not dealing with anything that you have to anymore. You know, you're out in Mother Nature, like on the water with the wind. You know, it's basically like therapy to some extent, and kiting's become that for me, but even more. It's something where I can go out and totally relieve myself of problems and come back in content and happy and peaceful. So it really helps me deal with, you know, different tragedies I've had to deal with in my life.
Wanted to do it downwind at El Moro. I mean, it's a really hard challenge, and I don't think anybody's really tried to do it before.
I'll tell you, it's a treacherous place. There's really strong rip currents, the sharks there, rocks, waves. The wind shear, or the rotors that we get out of there, are really strong because the wind's kind of blocked, and then once you get around the corner of the fort, the wind just doubles in speed, so you really don't know what's gonna happen until you get there.
Only a few riders are really up for this, so we're just gonna head up to San Juan and just go for it.
Funky weather. We got a metal hook, stainless steel hook, with a kite that is much larger than Ben Franklin's, I'm sure. It's not really the smartest thing to do. hanging out on water with a big old kite and a metal hook around your waist. That's going to be
bad idea.
Yesterday.
No, no. So what we want to do is wait for the cell to come through. And if there's wind after the cell,
then you're fine. It's going to be steady.
Because if there's nothing behind,
just let it roll over you.
So we're going to wait.
Ready?
Break. Girls to the mall, boys wherever they want. We'll be back at noon. We get new bikinis.
The storm blew over and robbed us of all of our wind. But I figured, you know what? We've never been inside the fort, so why don't we head down and see what it's all about?
They got a parrot.
Let's see.
They killed a parrot. They killed two small boys and a little girl and a parrot on the road.
I decided it was time to take everybody in the historic Old San Juan and check it out. Those two are going to be sleeping in a nice cold cell. It's windy around here.
Sure they do.
Have you never been
around
here? It's
your green. Oh, no. What are you going to do? Scarred him for life. Right there. Coconut, almond, fudge. That's my favorite. There's always room in the tomb. I want to go in the tacky store right here.
It's like bargain shopping.
Tacky.
Yeah. Girls just want to have fun.
I like the way you move.
Needs a different outfit. A size smaller, I think, what she said.
Shopping with the girls. Excellent.
Rock and roll.
Wait, is it girls trying on the lingerie? Priceless.
Yeah.
We need some shots. We need to go find a bar.
Apparently we're gonna go try to find some manatees and go look around for some lobster and fish for dinner tonight. So I'm not really sure whose idea it was to get up this early, but somehow I think it's being blamed on me. We'll see how Bree feels about it in a minute.
Bree has a tendency when she's on top of the water to send the guys away with their tails between her legs because she started doing surface handle passes real early on, and you just watched her start riding. She was like a little rock star out there and stuff, and I definitely think that she's on her way up for bigger and better things. I think a lot of people counted her out in the beginning. She has the talent, but Bree's somebody who takes her time coming into it because she wants to do it right. She's got to look good when she's doing it. She wants it all together, and she'll just go out there and ride. And that's the kind of drive and a personality that we'll see her in the next year excelling at the top of these competitions.
I woke up super early in the morning to Paul, and he's like, dude, we're going snorkeling. And And I couldn't believe it because I've honestly never been snorkeling before. So they grabbed Bree, we couldn't find Top Hat, and so I was the guy in line, so I was stoked.
Damien is an absolutely amazing rider. He is so much fun to watch. I've already seen him winning competitions and beating the top pros out there. And I mean, when it comes to training, you gotta see this guy. He just sits there and watches everybody else, figures out their trick, and then goes out there and does it in front of them. And he does it so much better and so much more gracefully. He's a very spiritual guy, and I think that's what keeps him focused.
It's kind of a dark world, you know, not everybody, I have a bracelet, WWJD. A lot of people think it's just a bracelet, and for me, it's not necessarily I have to wear it or whatever. It's what I believe inside, so it's I don't have to express it to anyone, really. It's just, you know, me and God, I guess, I believe. And
my favorite thing about Damien is that he's always willing to help anybody out, no matter what the situation is.
Pink.
Do you want to carry this, or do you? You want to carry this, or? Seriously, I gotta have you guys carry a knife.
Why?
Just in case.
In case what?
Just take it.
No, he's taking it.
But I'm gonna help you. There's a shark eating you. I'm not gonna come over with the knife and be like, okay, we're good.
Better.
I'm gonna take them to Enrique. It's gonna be given flat water. They're gonna have no wind blowing at them in the lower level. They're actually gonna be able to hear what we're saying. And we're gonna make them just go for it and just really see what we can get out of them. And I think you're gonna be surprised at what you're gonna see. Lazy kiting. I don't believe in pumps. Once you're above 35, you don't have to pump up kites.
Looks like it's a one at a time pump up and one at a time setup.
My predictions for the day?
Predictions. It's gonna get windier.
I got big balls. Bouncy big balls.
He came in and like, I got up at 6:30 and he came walking in. He had a big dent in his hat. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing? He's like, oh, I'm just coming in.
He just got done sleeping in the bushes.
He's like, yeah, he was sleeping in the bushes. He's like, yeah, I got it. Top Hat's my bro. I mean, there's not a lot of people I say about that. He represents the spirit of kiting to me, no matter how crazy it is, because Top Hat does what he wants. He dresses like he likes to dress. He's always dressed like that. That hat's on, you know, when he's sleeping. He meets people that he meets. I've seen him meet little three-year-old kids, and I've seen him meet 60-year-old adults, and I've seen the pro riders going, wanting to get around him because he's so cool. He's such a well-balanced out there, and he's doing what he wants in life. Don't let him fool you. The guy is highly intelligent. He's definitely given me some advice on stuff in life.
Make friends. It's way better than enemies.
And in kiting, it's really set it apart. And man, I look forward to any time I get to spend some time with him.
What happened last night?
It's kind of blurry, you know, bushes, people, friends. blurry, man. Puerto Ricans.
Oh. I need a sunblock. Do you have any sunblock?
Antoine and Julie, originally they're from France, but they were staying on the San Juan side. Now they're only 2.5 hours away, yet they'd never been down to this spot, so that just shows you how of a quiet or a secret location that the place actually was.
We bought 2 one-way tickets to San Juan, 4 big bags, and moved down here.
We were looking for a spot where it would be windy, it'd be warm, and also we'd have a big city.
Riding with Julie is always, it's very fun. We've been a couple for 4 years now. We met in college, and we just kind of met through friends, through sports, and we've always traveled, done sports together. Very untraditional relationship. For us, an idea of a good day is to go out kiting together. We don't do the usual, I mean, we live as a couple, we do a lot of things, but we do a lot less dinner and movie kind of dates.
Kiters tend to love it down here because these areas help produce unbelievable winds. The mangroves and shallow waters help create these thermals and lifting effect. We call it the elevator.
And a place like La Peguera, where you can just come in full speed, jump over mangroves, catch a thermal, and you're just cruising. You should land, but you catch this thermal. Brings you up.
The wind is so powerful when you're out there. You get to control it with your board speed and your kite speed. The kite is full of so much power that can pull you up. You can jump 30 feet if you want, and you come back down just as soft as you went up.
It's so flat in front of the mangroves. You can come in, and it's just the flattest water, and you can set up your trick. It's so easy. And it's so clear, and people are hanging out. You can do a jump right next to them. Up for the afternoon, so I gotta break down my 14, so I hit a 12. Getting a little too powered. That's a good thing.
Crazy. It's so gusty and so strong, but it's actually really cool. I mean, man, it's a major buzz. I was on a 16.
We'd all been throwing pretty big airs all day out at Enrique, and Antoine was definitely starting to go off. I showed him where to grab the thermals right by the mangroves, and boy, when he started hitting them, he started going huge. Thank you. horizon and saw this huge black thunderhead. The storm literally just came in so fast.
Squalls come through, and usually it's just a rain squall. This one was like a friggin' hit us, and it went from 25, 30 maybe, to like 62. Like,
we saw the storm come in slowly, and the wind was switching, and all of a sudden it hit.
Everybody got caught by surprise. Thunder, lightning, people were screaming, everybody was freaking out, and Antoine just got blown right out to sea, and we had to go rescue him.
So the storm was wild, but as quick as it blew in, it blew right out again. So we just sort of hung out there in the mangroves and chilled and waited for the seas to calm down. And finally, after about an hour or two, we made our way back in.
Sharing storm stories. I knew this was going to go all night, so a few of us headed into town and grabbed some empanadas and a few beers.
Gumbies? Come on. Kiteboarding.
We're just so excited to see another girl giving it a shot.
Women and men, you always have competition there. And you see women on local spots being better than most men. And the acceptance, people are just accepting it and enjoying that. Seeing women go out and kite. Kiting is a finesse sport, and women have an advantage for that. Much more graceful on the water.
I came through the gorge about 5 years ago as a whitewater kayaker. I was traveling with a group of kayakers and came to the Gorge Games to check it out. I saw the kiting event and it looked so fun that I decided to buy a kite and give it a whirl. And I did and loved it. Left to go to Canada to go kayaking some more with this group and decided I just couldn't handle it anymore. I really wanted to play with my new toys. So I hitched a ride back to the gorge and ended up living in my car for a month there and kited as much as I could and just got the fever and came back the next year and lived in my truck again and a little trailer that I bought.
At first I wasn't really comfortable with like surfing and stuff because when I got tumbled in the water I felt like I was stuck in an avalanche or under the snow and I would freak out. But kiteboarding is so different. I never really get stuck under the water that way. Felt like I had to almost make a choice because after that I didn't know if I wanted to go on doing sports, extreme sports, and live that lifestyle or just go back and have a career or something. But I think that the accident took me to Hawaii, and I'm so happy that I did not just move into a big city and go for the money, but for the love of the sport and the outdoors. I'm really happy now, I love it.
I grew up skiing. I skied since I was about 3 years old. My other sport before then was soccer. I played that since I was in first grade. And I just finished in senior year of high school. You know, I was on the ODP team, the Olympic Development Program. I started snowboarding when I was around 14 or 15. And I went to the Nationals and I started kiting just like 2 years ago. And I've been doing it ever since. I haven't snowboarded since then.
I've never really been addicted to something like I have kiteboarding.
Being in the sport, in the beginning of the sport, the girls are more accepted, I think, than maybe they were in the start of surfing or
snowboarding or skateboarding.
It's really interesting to me that women aren't pushed more by the industry in the sport because it's beautiful. It's a beautiful sport, and the women that do it are gorgeous, all of them. They're beautiful, healthy women, and they're out there having a great time, encouraging people in the sport.
There's always new people coming into it, young people. You know, in 2 years from now, there's gonna be 17-year-old girls kicking my ass.
We can just get a wave, back for the next one, back for the next one, and just launch up into the air. We're not stuck to the water.
As the week progressed, some of the riders wanted to go explore the island and take a day off from kiting, and I really think they needed it.
So excited to go check out and explore the beauty and the diversity of Puerto Rico.
Today we're gonna head over to the rainforest. We're gonna explore, go on an adventure tour.
So I'm so excited because I've never seen a rainforest before. So it should be pretty awesome. We don't have like a fixed itinerary. We're just gonna cruise around, and if we see somewhere where we think we might like to stop, we're just gonna stop and check it out.
So we're just driving around, and all of a sudden we see this fruit stand.
What do you think, mango?
It is. It's, oh, you know what I bet it's like yuca.
Sí, listo para comer.
So we stopped and found some beautiful mangoes and just kicked back and enjoyed some
Here.
Tropical fruit.
I love those.
We're just gonna go and cruise around and see what we can enjoy for a nice day off.
We had to hike up a little bit this path to find the waterfall. It was just amazing up there. It's like a big ohana, like we felt the aloha around there.
I did not realize that this would be so incredible. It's just one of those perfect dream spots.
A few others went with Julie to kite at Guanica. Guanica is about 30 minutes east of Bregera. It's got this really cool small beach that goes through this lagoon with butter flat water.
It smells good. Think it fits? Where are the riders?
This is where we are going.
Wow, what's that? Look at that
thing. It's like a kid. That's like me when I was like five in the car. What's that?
Thank you.
We're going to take Cameron and Antoine and Damien and Andy, and we're just going to take them out and just, I've been riding with these guys now for so long, and we've gained another respect level for each other out here, and I'm going to push them.
When we all ride together with Antoine, Cameron, Paul, everyone, you always push it.
It's going to be four of us pushing it as hard as we can, doing our own style of riding.
It was like right over the can. It had to have been good, dude. Even though board off from like 4 years ago, but I was so
I'm 38.
Amigo. You tired? I heard you were killing it out there.
Yeah, how was it over?
Beautiful.
Yeah?
Yeah, it was fun.
That's sick.
Nice place. Very shallow. It was this deep.
Was it windy? It was cranky.
It was pretty windy.
It was good.
Kiting has become this thing that people look at, a visual sport that it's incredible to watch.
It's a really cool balance and integration of speed, action, adrenaline, and this like floating feeling of total freedom.
I mean, I can go out and jump 50 feet in there. I mean, how many places can you do that?
You gotta understand, there's this unbelievable connection with spirit, nature, and your friends when you kite. There's an energy that you create together that's just incredible. Everybody got together that I wasn't sure if everybody was gonna get along, and definitely that energy got created. And all of a sudden, by the end of the week, man, everybody was just so tight. We were definitely that tribe. Tonight on the Rail is a celebration of that bond, the good times we had this week, and most importantly, the friendships. So we took our boats out to Rail for one last time under a nice starry sky.
We got watermen, not firemen.
The end of the trip, we survived this fire, means we survived the week. A lot of interesting things have happened this week. All of you came here to get away and relax from the competition and traveling. And that's why we're here, to share our sport and love we have for it with everyone else. I think opened our eyes up to some different things as far as sportsmanship, actually going out and having some fun, getting to some wind that's 47 knots, fine top hat sleeping on your front door. I carved this out of a piece of bamboo that I found. We're gonna all drink out of this together. Best trick of the day was Cameron lighting this fire. For our first drink to light the ceremonial drinking torch, which you guys will find very interesting. Thought flaming shots in Old San Juan were fun.
Got it. Wait a minute. Fell short.
Anything we do, we all do together. Put it up. Ladies up. All four of you in there.
Whoa.
Oh!
Yes!
No spilling.
I've done so many things on a kite that I just can't imagine that, you know, you can take one sport so many different places.
It's really taught me more to appreciate each day that I'm given and to enjoy life for what it is, when it is, and not wait till the next day.
Every day we get more excited when more people come into the sport because it's just like more members of your family joining up.
It's only in its infancy. It's just gonna go so much further. We'll be right back.
My lip, 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 my l